Saint John of Damascus. Saint John of Damascus lived between 7th and 8th centuries. His father was a wealthy city official. At that time, the city of Damascus was under Saracen rule. While public confession of Christianity was forbidden, John's father was allowed to practice his faith freely, as he found favor with the Saracens, and he managed to get John baptized without much issue. His father wanted to find a proper teacher for his son, and for that he prayed fervently. The Lord heard his prayer in this manner. The Saracens had a slave market, and there John's father saw some slaves begging a certain slave monk to pray for them as they were led to be executed. The monk was weeping bitterly, and after John's father inquired, the monk said he's weeping because he has no children to leave them his inheritance. Perplexed by this, John's father asked him how could he have children, as he is a monk. The monk, in return, said that his inheritance was all manner of sciences that he studied while being a freeman in Italy, as well as considerable theological training. Rejoicing at this, John's father immediately begged the caliph to give him that slave monk, whose name was Cosmas. In that way, the Lord heard the prayer of two men. The father found a worthy teacher for his son and his stepson, whose name was also Cosmas, and the monk found gifted pupils to teach. Both John and Cosmas advanced fast. Once he felt that he had nothing else to teach them, the monk departed to a monastery. That is where Emperor Leo the Isaurian comes into the picture. You remember him? He was the villain from the life of Saint Theodosia. Well, he's back. So, he decides to ban veneration of icons, and Saint John would have none of it. Immediately, he starts writing long epistles in defense of the holy icons, sending them far and wide to the Roman Empire. Emperor Leo was annoyed at this, but Saint John was out of his reach. That is when he had a cunning plan. He obtained one of St. John's epistles, and using forgers, he made a counterfeit letter in which, supposedly, he calls the emperor to invade Damascus, all the while providing intelligence regarding the army. Emperor Leo sent this forged letter to the Saracen leader, saying that he has a traitor in his ranks, and that he, Leo, is exposing him in order to promote goodwill between the two dominions. So, the caliph calls St. John and demands an explanation. The saint said that, while the handwriting is uncanny to his own, he never wrote such a thing. The caliph, not convinced, ordered his right hand chopped off and put on a spike in the city square. Later that day, and feeling ill due to all the blood loss, and upon learning that caliph's wrath has waned, St. John asked him to return the hand to him, claiming that he would feel restless until he gives it a proper burial. The caliph sent him the hand, and immediately St. John takes it before the icon of the Theotokos and begins to pray fervently for healing. As he does, he falls asleep and sees in a vision the Mother of God. She heals his hand and bids him to defend the holy icons with his healed hand. When St. John awoke, his hand was whole, with only a thin red line to indicate where it was cut. He organized a large celebration at his house, and the sound of the music attracted Caliph's attention. He summoned St. John and demanded an explanation for such jubilation, and seeing that his hand was whole, he demanded to see the doctor who could rejoin an arm so fast. Upon hearing that it was Christ who healed him, the Caliph realized that he had sinned against an innocent man. He immediately offered St. John his previous post and even more worldly power. However, he rejected it all and decided to become a monk together with his stepbrother, Cosmas. The napkin which Saint wore to cover the stub of his arm he has since worn as a turban. To additionally honor his healing, Saint John added a third hand to the icon. It wasn't painted, but a metal votive offering attached to the icon. That is why the icon is called Trerucica, or She of the Three Hands. But wait, ask all the Serbs, what happened to the icon? Well, that is a story for another time. Saint John came to the monastery, and he wanted to submit himself to a spiritual father. The issue was, not one of the monks wanted to be his spiritual father, for he was famous for his education. Finally, a certain elderly monk took him without an issue. Saint John had to follow a very strict regimen, that he does nothing according to his own will. to offer up all of his prayers and toils as a sacrifice to God, to weep that by his tears he may cleanse his prior sins, never to ponder anything worldly, never to imagine any indecent sight, never to praise himself for his learning, never to desire any special revelations or visions, never to be so assured in his mind to think that he cannot fall into error, never to write letters, and finally, never to speak of secular sciences. Saint John immediately took up all of these rules and followed them closely. One day, in order to test him, his spiritual father told him that the baskets that the monks weave fetch a far higher price in Damascus than in Palestine. He is to go over to Damascus and sell the baskets, but not to sell them under a specified price, which was quite high. Saint John went to Damascus and attempted to sell the baskets. However, he could sell none because they were so overpriced. People inquired, and upon hearing how expensive they were, they laughed or openly mocked him. No one recognized him, for his face was drained from all the fasting. One of the citizens, his former slave, recognized him and, feeling sorry for his former master and pretending not to know him, immediately bought all the baskets in order to spare him the future ridicule. That way, Saint John returned to the monastery as if some victor from a battle, putting to shame devil and his pride. Once, a certain monk in the monastery died. His brother asked Saint John, who was also a gifted poet, to write a funeral hymn for him. The saint protested, saying that he shouldn't do anything without his elder's blessing. The elder, at the time, was on a certain voyage. He finally agreed to do it, seeing that it would bring considerable comfort to the brother of the deceased. As he wrote this funeral troparia, he also sang them, and his spiritual father heard it as he was approaching his cell. Accusing him of pride, he kicked him out of their cell. Saint John felt like Adam kicked out of paradise, and he immediately went to the other elders of the monastery that they might convince his spiritual father to accept him back. The old man finally relented, but under one condition. Saint John's penance was to clean all the latrines in the monastery by hand. So, the elders go to Saint John, and they tell him that the old man decided to take him back, but none of them wanted to tell him what was his penance, because it was so unseemly. After much begging by John, they tell him what it was, and Saint John couldn't be happier. He could finally have his sin forgiven. Saint John immediately started to clean, and that hand that used to defend icons, that hand which was healed by the Mother of God, that hand was now touching filth in order to reach perfect humility. The spiritual father, seeing Saint John's humility, immediately took him back, and they lived in perfect accord as before. And then, the elder had a very special and a very furious visitor. It was the Mother of God, and she ordered the elder to immediately allow Saint John to write and compose, as for this reason she healed his hand in the first place. Upon waking from the vision, the old man allowed Saint John to write many wondrous books on the Orthodox doctrine, in defense of the holy icons, and many liturgical songs in use to this day. He was ordained to the holy priesthood by his stepbrother, now a bishop, but not wanting to spend his life in the world, he returned to his beloved monastery where he gave up his soul. By his prayers, O Christ our God, save us and bless us and make us worthy of your kingdom to come. Amen.